Welcome back to our studies of typical endgame ideas. Mark, which one are we going to learn in this video?
Yeah, you remember that we analyzed one endgame, initial endgame, Dvoretsky-Taimanov, and then we discussed various typical problems which we met in this endgame. So we already discussed several of them. Now next problem, which we still didn't discuss, it's cut and king off.
Okay.
In rook endgame, it's extremely typical device, extremely important device. When you play for a win, when you play for a draw, it's important for both sides. Mm-hmm. There are many theoretical positions where it's part of theory, where you should know exactly how to do it. It's a pity that sometimes we ignore it in practical game, forget about it somehow, and don't use this technique. Usually results are quite bad, and once, unfortunately, I suffered from it myself. I played quite successfully against some top players. One of them had plus score against some players of very good strengths, like Smyslov, Polugayevsky, Belyavsky, and some other. Equal score with some other, like Petrosyan, Keres, and... I had very good score against Bernstein, but once I missed a very easy win. It was very pity because I would play him quite well in this game. I was black. But in very last moment, I made primitive mistake. It's position which now in the board.
See.
I already won 2 points. And,
good start.
Yeah, I expected easy win, but unfortunately, now I was already too relaxed.
Black to move, yeah?
Black to move. I have 2 points, but the only problem is that it's F H. So A and C, it's the same. Like F and H points. And now,
since our topic is cutting off the king,
yes,
the only way I can do it is rook h3.
Yes,
here, yeah?
In such situation, cut and king off from the dagger, horizontal sometimes much more effective than if you vertical cut and king off. This rook h3 would win immediately, would stop king to fight against pawn after king if I have rook c3. Or b3 also very good, but even rook c3, and then I want to improve position slowly, king a3, a4, and so on. And not clear what I can do without a king don't participate in this fight, so it's just elementary
game over.
No any problems. Yeah, unfortunately, no, I already relaxed. I thought that it's already elementary win, and I played quickly. I decided that I need to free my king, so bring rook to b4. Mm-hmm. I played rook h4 check, king d4, king d3, rook b4.
Still looks good, no?
And now he made a very good prophylactic move. My point was to play king b3, of course.
Yeah, king b3.
Yeah, right, after right? Rook a6, I would play king b3 and would win. Yeah. But he played rook c6. And now king b3 already doesn't win. But without it...
It was with the a-pawn.
Yes,
draw, eh?
Yes. He can play checks, for example, yeah. Maybe something else. Yeah. And so I was forced to play king b5, then rook c8. Mm-hmm. And next move will be king c3, and we get standard situation with a c-pawns drawn position, and I didn't win this position, it's drawn. No, but I didn't make next own mistake. Mm-hmm. So for me it was very pity, it's, I already had win in pocket. But elementary device, cutting king off.
Many people forget about this, cutting them off on the ranking. Yeah. Because you want to go rook d5, but that's not possible.
For me, it was when I played actively, I had some serious drawbacks, and one of them was I played too quickly. I trusted the first impression. So I decided immediately that I should play rook h4, rook b4, king b3, and didn't check it accurately and didn't think about alternative. If I would stop for a moment and to see what else I can do, of course I would find it. But I very often played too quickly. without checking and lost a lot of important points in many tournaments. I knew about this drawback, but didn't have enough character had, enough determination to fight against it, to overcome it. When I started to work like trainer, for me it was very important to find drawbacks, such weaknesses of my student, and help them to avoid them. It's the way how they became stronger. But unfortunately, I couldn't do it for myself.
It's always easier to fix others than ourselves.
Yeah. Because when you help to another person, it's enough to understand, to evaluate correctly. Okay. I was able always to do it. But when you work for yourself, you also should have determination, will to do something unpleasant, something which you didn't do before. And many players can do it easily. They need only to know what to do. Right. But other people like me, had another problem. I knew what I should do, but had no enough determination. It's pity, of course.
Yeah, I'm the same way. I know myself very well, but my laziness keeps winning.
Yeah.
Anyway, we're not the only ones. Speaking of laziness, our dear friend Peter Svidler.
Yeah. By the way, Peter, of course, great player, and his drawbacks are not exactly the same like mine, but same features he had. It's a very instructive position, and that's very instructive also because we will have additional a case to speak about problem which we already discussed here about rules, violation of rule and so on. Okay, f and h again, standard.
Trying to figure out what's going on.
Yeah, black pawn on but white has additional pawn on h6, which black of course can eliminate if he wants. Yeah, so I should also add that before a few moves earlier, Svidler's position was completely lost. Mm-hmm. But Topalov didn't play accurately, and now maybe Svidler got chances. Mm-hmm. So, first I will show you what was happened in the game. In the game, black played very quickly. King h7, white protected pawn rook b6. He played rook d2 check, king g3, rook d1, f4, he resigned. Because if white would have only f4 and h3 pawn, it would be easy draw. If white would have h6 and f4 pawn, it also would be easy draw. But with additional pawn on h3, white king has asylum on h file. And king goes a hit.
So you could just go rook f6, king h4, king h5.
Black has no check from the rear.
So, also, all the pawn endings are always winning if you go, let's say, rook g6, rook g7 at some point.
Maybe. But here it's even more easy. I want to play king g4, king g5 with a threat check. Rook g1, king h5, rook d5, f5, so black, what black can do against it.
Yeah.
So he lost without resistance. So such position with three pawns, it's lost, completely lost. So, but first question, natural question. It's a little bit strange why Svidler didn't take pawn back. King h7, rook d6 or rook h5, both moves are possible. Why he started to play without three pawns? He could play without two pawns. Okay, I can explain. It happens sometimes that your knowledge just can help you. It's exactly the same story. What we can say? Position with pawns and f and h usually in many cases are drawn position, but there are some exceptions. And some exceptions we can use like additional rules.
I know it's lost if your king is cut off for example.
Sure, and background. It's clear that Svidler knew it all as well. So he thought about a move like rook d6 or rook h5 that white can cut king off on 7th rank and then. So we get position where king on 8th rank and he knew that such position lost. So it's
here maybe.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll get into it, I guess, but here maybe I can attack the pawns.
Right. It's a point. If white would have pawn on h4 and h, maybe even h2, No, H2 maybe not, or F4, yeah, so it would be, this rule would work, and it really would be, but here is just concrete moment, king g3, yeah, it's king g2, and important on that, okay, rook is too is close to pawn, you remember I told you about three line, which you need to have, but here it's not important just because position of pawns, no, say king f4, no, rook h6, rook f6, doesn't matter, king g4, rook g6, check, and normal move king f5, but unfortunately rook g3 attacks to attacks.
And this works too?
Rook h6, I don't remember.
No, it says this is losing.
It's losing because h4. Oh. And after capture, king g6.
Yeah.
But you have rook g3, you can attack two pawns immediately, simultaneously, and get normal draw. So it's just concrete detail of position. Mm-hmm. Two pawns in the same line. And some horizontal. So the rule doesn't work here. This standard relation. Of course, to calculate such line for Peter, it's not a great problem. He is a great player. But I told you about some drawbacks which he had, perhaps like me. He's an emotional guy. He dislike to do something which isn't pleasant for him. My impression that he had bad position before. He saw that maybe even if I'll get round position, okay, I still need to work hard and perhaps I will make mistake later on. Yeah, Topalov is a very strong, determinated player. He will fight. So he didn't believe that he can escape. I had the same problem very often. He was pessimistic about his chances here. So he didn't try to work hard. Didn't want to fight at his maximum because he didn't believe that it will be successful. So he used his knowledge. He saw that, okay, rook d7 is threat, so maybe I need to play king h7, and perhaps it's also lost, but illusion, but at least we will see. If he will cut me off, it will be certainly losing. So this knowledge was harmful for him. It forced him to play the stupid move king h7. By the way, there is also small problem. If you would like to make a draw by attacking pawn, what is more accurate move, rook h5 or rook d6?
Yeah, I was wondering if it's the same.
Is the same or not? Yeah.
Not rook b6, but it looks like a draw, rook h3. But maybe there's a difference because here, If I take now, I can give check.
Yeah, king g7, so and draw, one more check. You cannot, and one more check. You cannot go to 6th rank. You should go to 8th rank, and now I advance my pawn, and we get standard situation with king, which is cut, is locked on 8th rank. So standard evaluation work now. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so we have tempo for h4. But what's the difference?
And if rook d6, king g3, I can give a check, I guess.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, I can change order of the move. Instead of king g3, I can play h4.
I need to be clever now.
Yes, I don't need to take this pawn with the rook. I can, king goes out from 8th rank. And now it's the standard situation with the FNH pawn, their own situation. So not rook h5, because this idea, two checks. But this move leads to a draw. Yeah.
Still a lot of work, of course. Many people lose this, but
But this position is drawn, so we have good chances don't lose. I believe that it's a nice example because it demonstrates many important details, psychological, some lack of confidence, how it can harm player.
Yeah, knowledge that which you should, when you cut off.
Knowledge which can help you, but sometimes can harm you if you trust too much standard evaluation. Because no rules without exceptions, you know. And this is exactly exception. Rook b7 doesn't win. Yeah, and so on. So I like this example.
Apologies to Peter.
Yeah.
What's the next? Savon Selyandinov.
Я из Туроша. Савон из Grandmaster. I'm not sure that he was Grandmaster at this moment when he played the game. So he played old game. Желендинов is good master. And black to move. What black's choice?
I like taking pawns, but I have a feeling since that's not our topic.
Yeah, capture of pawn, problem of capture of pawn that king goes to g6 and to d6. No, black king should go out because checkmate will threaten, and d pawn will be very strong. We play check, king e7. Yeah, actually it was happened in the game.
Okay.
And black lost because the pawn is too strong.
Just game away on pawn runs.
Yeah, it was a position what happened in the game. Rook d4, d6. For example, if h4 now, then d7, h3, d8 takes, rook takes, h2, rook d1.
Just on time, yeah.
Yeah. So, he played a few more moves and resigned. Yeah. So again, it's to be not so good to be greedy. It's again, about materialism. Black has a very instructive way of defense. Starting from cutting king off, because d6 is a really very weak pawn. Black has no other weaknesses. It's king on e8, all pawns of king side protected well, no breakthrough. So d6 is the only weakness. Let's check. Say rook takes a4.
I'll check.
You can play check or any other move. By the way, there is also additional opportunity for black to go to pawn endgame, king d7, rook a7, rook c7.
I'd be very scared. This is strong.
Black should lose pawn. So only chance of black is to play f6, break through at some moment. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we can check this line, but actually this breakthrough doesn't help black. We can check some line. It's an opportunity which should be calculated for black, but actually it doesn't work. This f6 will not help black. Mm-hmm. Immediately, or king d7 first, king b6, then f6. Or even king e7, then f6. So you can check various options, mm-hmm. but all of them doesn't work.
Why not?
Yeah, okay, we can check. Takes, g5, takes, perhaps, h4, no, g6.
Okay, it's just winning.
Yeah. You could try king e8 also, after g6. But then perhaps my king will help me to win. Perhaps king d6, h2, g7, king f7, g8, takes, king e7, h1, f7, and f8 check, two extra pawns, absolutely winning position. again, as usually, very famous sentence of Tartakover, chess is strategy of single tempo. it's always just one tempo. We had luck of just single tempo, all this. All nine, you have no reserve. it's winning.
But why do I need to go to the pawn endgame?
Yeah.
I just wait.
Wait, king b6, and wait. There is, white can try to break through. Only chances to pass c-file with king somehow.
Mm-hmm.
Question how to do it. White can try, for example, check, king e7, or king d7, or check, king e8. And now it's an essential feature. Rook c7 is perhaps only try for white. Yeah, you have no other check. Try. And now black has important move, rook a2. And you see, rook c7, rook is not well located on c7. If rook would be another square, it would be okay. But if you will go to b, here check, king b7, and back. If you would play rook c6, I can meet you with king d7. If you play rook on if rook c7, rook b7, I will play rook c2.
Way to improve.
No way. Yeah, it's a destructive situation, which enable black to make a draw. So this is that fortress based on cutting king off. Yeah.
Once again, not the right time to grab a pawn.
Yeah.
Okay. You have one more example, right?
Yes.
Well, this looks familiar.
Yeah, it's Baku World Cup, perhaps, or Grand Prix, FIDE Grand Prix, I don't remember exactly the tournament, Baku 2008. Mm-hmm. Karjakin against Wang Yu. Wait to move.
King is already cut off.
Yes, black king is cut off.
I'd like to take a pawn, as usual.
Yeah.
So if I play whatever king f2, you attack my pawn with rook a3, maybe.
Black wants to attack white pawns.
Mm, yes. I don't know what to do. I guess this taking the pawn is wrong.
What's wrong here? Problem is king position endgame. Yes. So we didn't speak about it. But actually, activation of king position is an extremely important principle of endgame. Of course, in many kind of endgame. And here, some advantage of white position here. If you can say something about advantages, because there are many disadvantages here. But only plus of white position is black king cut off from the center, from queen side and so on. It's and defense should, white defense should based on this factor. It's extremely important. So I believe that white shouldn't take the pawn just because it's allow black king became active.
Mm-hmm.
With white king, which is far from queen side. So I would suggest to play simply king f2.
Well, I thought I was losing my pawn.
Okay, now I have two choices.
Mm-hmm.
I can defend accurately. King e2, rook takes b2, b3, king d2. My king now can will protect pawn on c4. You cannot win this pawn with the rook. But then already I can take on c6, e6, and play rook c6.
Six.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
And,
it's 2-1 is a draw.
Yeah. Or not rook c6, but rook a8 maybe after that. Yeah, and e6. So, but my king will help me to defend this position. Mm. Yeah, I use it, black king doesn't play. I had another more aggressive approach also after king f2, rook a3. I can play king e3, give up second pawn. Rook takes, king e4, rook c3. Now, automatical move, rook g6. It's don't hurry principle. It's clear that better to play with king, which is far from the play. King somewhere, h5, rook takes e6.
And then rook the king f4. Comes to c6. Yeah?
Perhaps. Or maybe king f5 also not bad. They do rook c6. So, white pawn is so strong, pawn which protected, which supported by all pieces, all white pieces so active that two extra pawn of black not so essential. So it's also a very good way to defend. You so you see, you even have a choice. More aggressive or more accurate. And perhaps both are good for a draw.
And Karjakin,
Karjakin took pawn. And black, of course, didn't play rook a3 because, again, white can cut king off, rook f6. And when you push, after that, rook f6, perhaps, maybe, and then e pawn, maybe king f2 first, to strengthen the threat a6.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so e pawn is very strong, king don't fight against it. But when you played correctly, king f5, rook e7, and now rook a3. So if rook takes c7, then king takes e5.
Dropping.
Yeah, it's one extra pawn for black. Black will have one extra pawn, but we had similar position, but with white king on e2 and on d2 and black king somewhere on g4. But now it's opposite. Black king is active, white king is far from the game. So it's completely lost. No, I also checked passive defense. It also doesn't help. help. After rook e7, rook e3, rook f7, check, king takes e5, rook f3. Black can, for example, play for breakthrough, b5, maybe.
B5 immediately?
Yeah, why not? Okay. To use pin. Pawn, if rook e3, king d4, rook g3, pawn takes c4. If pawn takes b5, then c4.
I don't get.
And this pin is something wrong with position. King. Just a moment.
Oh, this looks like a drop.
Rook f7, king. F, e takes e5, rook f3, b5.
Maybe this is winning, yeah. I can't
go. Ah, yes, 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 of course. It takes all pawns, yes.
Yeah, I thought it was a draw, but
yes,
black is in time.
Of course. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So it's a forced to win.
Mm, nice.
In the game he played e6. It also doesn't help. Rook takes b3. King f2. Rook b4.
Rook takes.
If king e3, rook c4, rook c7, rook e4 check. King d3, rook d4 check. I prepared move rook d6, and now I can take pawn on e6. Already two extra pawn.
Mm-hmm.
Easy win. In the game he immediately took pawn on e6, c7. King takes e6. No, if king e3, then king d6, and then takes on c4.
Two pawns.
But yeah, protect pawn on b6. Not, yeah. Mm-hmm. So he played rook h7, rook takes c4. Maybe he could win by other way.
Yeah,
but well, he decided that it's enough. Rook h6, king d5. Rook takes b6, and now...
Back to the topic.
Yes. Yes, of course. Cut king off. No, it's completely win.
This even I can win.
Yeah. Oh, it can resign. Well, yeah, it was happened in the game. Exactly, this line. Last accurate move, king e3, opposition. Not king e3, but king e3. It's how games ended. White resigned to exactly this position.
Yeah. Good technique by Wang Yuan.
Yes, he actually had a good technique. He won many good endgames. And here it's an instructive endgame. But started from technical mistake of Karekin. He didn't use the advantage of his position, cut and king off, allowed black king became active. And after that position became lost. So in many situations in rook endgame, this device works. And the reasons for cut and king offs can be absolutely different. We saw
if it's on ranks or files, it works both ways.
Yes. So it's... I have many examples on this topic, but maybe it's enough. What do you think? Or we can demonstrate anything else.
But no, I think for this video, those are the ones we had, and we'll leave it there.
Okay.
Thanks a lot, and see you guys in the next video.
Yeah.